Everyone, welcome to the Melissa West YouTube yoga channel. As you can probably tell, I am not Melissa West, but I am here today to present you with a yin yoga class for beginners. My name is Kassandra Reinhardt and I run the Yoga with Kassandra YouTube channel and I do specialize in yin yoga. So me and Melissa decided to collaborate and do a video for each other's channel. If you enjoyed today's practice and want to do more yin yoga with me, I encourage you to come subscribe over to my channel. And while you're here, also definitely subscribe to Melissa's yoga channel. We are going to need one block and one strap for today's yoga practice. If you don't happen to own these props, it's not a big deal. So a great replacement for a strap is a belt. So just like a regular belt for your pants, that'll work really well. And if you don't happen to own a block, you can get some really thick or dense cushions, or you can even grab a really large book. Some people who might have a little bit more flexibility might not even need to use any props for this practice, but it's always good to have a couple options around you just in case. So if you are unfamiliar with the practice of yin yoga, it's quite different from other styles such as hatha or vinyasa or power yoga. So instead of focusing on our muscles, in yin yoga, most of the focus is on our joints and on our connective tissues. So we do not warm up before practicing yin yoga, which I know a lot of people think is kind of strange. But by not warming up, we're able to send the stress and send the benefits of the poses to our connective tissues and to our joints as opposed to our muscles. And in yin yoga, we are holding poses for an extended period of time. So it can be anywhere from 2 to 8 minutes, depending on what we're doing. So we always want to make sure that we're not pushing ourselves too far. Yin yoga is an amazing way to gain some flexibility and increase your range of motion in your joints. But because we are in the poses for such a long time, the student has to be very mindful and very respectful of their own body's limitations and any injuries that you might be working with. So I always like to tell people, if you're looking at a scale of 1 to 10 for intensity, where 10 is really painful, in yin yoga, you want to stay at about a 4 or a 5. So just enough so that you are feeling a stretch, but not so much so that it's really hard for you to hold the pose or you feel other areas of your body starting to tighten up and contract. This is a beginner friendly yin yoga sequence, and we're actually just going to start sitting up in a comfortable position. It can be cross-legged like I am, or up on a block if that works a little better for you. And we're just gonna open up the neck. So one of my favorite things to do. Sitting up nice and tall, drop the shoulders down and away from the ears, and you want your chin parallel to the ground. You're just going to drop your right ear towards your right shoulder. So the chin is still slightly elevated here, and you should start to feel this a little bit towards the left side of your neck. If you'd like to make this a little bit more intense, a little juicier, you can reach your left fingertips out to the side, and you can even bring your right hand to rest over the top of the head. So instead of applying a downward pressure on your neck, think instead of pulling the ear a little bit further away from the shoulder, so you're increasing that space there. So find your intensity, that 4 or 5 on a scale of 1 to 10, just enough so that you feel sensation, but it's not painful in any kind of way. And once you find yourself in your version of the pose, you can let the eyes close or the gaze soften. And you can slow down your breath, inhaling and exhaling through the nose. This is a deeply meditative and introspective practice. It gives us an opportunity to drop in and really just see what's going on, physically, emotionally, energetically. Notice where your mind tends to go. If you get distracted easily, just bring the focus back to your breathing.
So if you had your right hand over the top of the head, you can bring it underneath your head and just use arm strength to lift all the way back up to center. And release the palms back onto the knees. Just close the eyes and take a breath or two here. Notice the difference from one side to the other. And we'll go and move over to the other side. So this time, left ear toward your left shoulder. Stay here, or right fingertips can reach out to the side. Maybe the left hand goes to the top of the head, just to really stretch the ear further away from the top of the shoulder. Nothing changes in the spine. You are still lifted up tall, grounding down through the sit bones. Breathing all the way down to the belly. This time, left hand under the head. Slowly lift all the way back up, hands on the knees. Take a few breaths just to observe the effects of this pose. Blinking the eyes open, let's move into our butterfly fold. So the soles of the feet will come together to touch, knees fall open. So you're welcome to put a block underneath the knees or underneath the hips if you feel like you're rolling and falling backwards. Elevating the hips will make it a little bit easier for you to tilt forward. And you can play with the distance that you have between the heels and the groin. So the closer you have your heels in towards you, the more you'll start to feel this towards the inner thighs and inner groin. And the further away they are, the more you'll probably feel this towards the outer edges of your legs. So find the positioning that works for you and feels the best for your hips. And we're going to walk our palms forward. So this is not a hatha yoga class. So we are not trying to maintain a flat back. In yin yoga, gravity is doing the work for us, and we want to relax the muscles, all muscles, as much as possible so that we can get into our joints as opposed to working the muscular body. So walking the palms forward, I like to turn my palms to face up to resist the temptation to push and pull. So there is none of that going on. And when you find your edge, you can let the spine naturally round and the head hang heavy. If you're somewhere close towards the floor, having a prop and placing it underneath the forehead or underneath the chest can make the pose a lot more comfortable, or you might prefer to just let yourself hang heavy. And because we are here for a few minutes, take your time to really get settled and find the positioning that works the best for you, so that once you are in the pose, you won't need to fidget or move, and you can just enjoy the sensations. So we're stretching all down the spine, deep into the hips.
Soften the shoulders and the chest and the neck. Let go a little bit more with every exhale. Bring some energy back into your arms. We need to go really slowly here. Be mindful of your lower back. Just walk the hands in inch by inch and keep your breath going as you lift out of the pose. No rush.
So once your shoulders are back up in line with the hips, you can bring your knees back in. Before we go to our next asana, you can bring the feet flat to the floor and just let your knees drop from side to side in a windshield wiper motion. We'll be making our way into a wide legged child's pose. So from your hands and knees, you'll bring the big toes together to touch, and the knees will really go as wide as you would like them to go. So the wider they are, the deeper the stretch will be towards the hips, low back, and inner groin. But if it feels like too much, just bring your knees a little bit closer towards one another. Otherwise, they can move towards the edges of the mat. And then you're walking your hands forward and melting the heart and the forehead, either down to the floor, or you can always put a block underneath the forehead if the mat is a little bit too far away. And again, just find your edge.
There's no need to push or pull or force your way into any kind of shape. And it's important that once you are in the pose, that you resolve to be still. By being still, you resist the urge to contract your muscles and engage them. And then the joints can really get the benefits of the pose. Notice if any tension has started to creep up into your neck. If any part of your body is trying to overcompensate for the stretch that you feel in the lower body. We're staying for one final minute. Really try to let go. And so from this pose, we're actually just going to slide onto our bellies to come into Sphinx. So do this really slowly. You can just straighten the legs and slide forward. Toes are pointing back, tops of the feet to the ground. And slide your forearms out in front of you. This is a backbending pose. You can modify this. You can decrease or increase the sensation that you feel through the low back and sacrum. So to go deeper into the pose, you bring your elbows closer to the shoulders. And to decrease the sensation, you bring your elbows and your palms further out in front of you so that you're a little bit closer towards the ground. Just choosing whichever one works for you. Hands and elbows are about shoulder width distance apart, maybe even a little bit wider. Tailbone is reaching towards the heels. Feel a nice lift through the chest, and you're pressing the shoulders back so that you're not rounding or contracting forward. Closing the eyes. Imagine you can send your breath directly down into your tailbone, into your low back, and right at the front of the heart.
Get the length of your inhale to be just as long as the exhale. Let's release to lie on our belly.
Give yourself a few breaths just to stack the palms and rest the forehead down. So our next pose will focus a little bit more on the knees and on the thighs. You may or may not need a strap here. So this is a laying quad stretch. Bending into your right knee, you're either going to hold on to the foot and pull it in towards you, or you can loop a strap around that foot and pull it in this way. And we're gonna let our forehead relax on the left arm. So hold on to whatever is accessible to you and try to keep your knees about hip-width distance apart. And you're not pulling the foot to the outer edge of your knee, but you're really just trying to keep it directly aligned so you're bringing it more toward the glute. So there's a little bit of arm strength required here, but we don't want to engage the legs too much. So if you were to engage the muscles here, you would feel this mostly in your quads and at the front of the thigh. But by relaxing those muscles, you should feel it a little bit more into the knee joint. And by applying this kind of stress, we are actually able to strengthen our joints and also improve the range of motion. Let's release the right foot really slowly. Just extend that leg back down to the floor. And we're going to switch sides. So you can bring your right forearm underneath your forehead. And either with or without a strap, you're bending the left knee, catching the foot or the ankle, wherever is accessible. And again, don't open that leg out to the side. Try to keep it in line with the glute and in line with the femur. And you're pulling the heel in towards you. Relaxing the legs, relaxing the chest, and breathing deeply. And gently release the hold of your left foot and left leg. And we're just going to roll onto our backs. So any way you need to get there. I'm just going to flip over. You can get rid of the strap if that's something that you have been using. I'm getting settled here. Let's finish with a lying spinal twist before moving into Shavasana. So you'll need to reach your arms out to the sides so the shoulders stay grounded to the floor, arms out into a T. And you can lift your hips and shift them a couple inches over towards the right before letting both knees drop down over to the left. Either with one leg stacked over the other, or you can twist a little bit deeper by crossing your right thigh over your left. You can also modify this by placing a block either in between the thighs or underneath the knees for more support. As much as possible, try to keep your right shoulder blade pressing and anchored to the floor. So the collarbones face up, and this twist is really just coming from the low or mid to low back and down into the hips. Send your breath all the way down into your low back and into the outer edge of your right hip. Take your last 10 or so deep breaths here. Notice the softening that occurs on the exhale. Letting yourself melt down into the floor underneath you. If you had your legs crossed like I do, gently uncross them. And we're going to float the knees back up one at a time. Coming back to center. And then we'll move over to the other side. So this time you'll need to lift your hips and shift them to the left before letting both knees drop over to the right, either with one knee stacked over the other or wrapping the left leg over. Remember, you can always place a block underneath your legs. Try to keep your left shoulder blade towards the ground so you're facing straight up. Just notice if any part of you is still trying to work hard here. Yin is a practice of allowing and of non-resistance, which can be quite challenging. Your last few breaths on this side. Crossing the legs, just floating the knees back up one at a time. We'll be coming into Shavasana, so if there are any other little movements or adjustments that feel good to you, you can either pull the knees into the chest or just let the knees drop from side to side. And when you are ready to come into corpse pose, into Shavasana, you can extend your legs and extend the arms, palms facing up. The low back feels sensitive in any way. You can put a block under each knee or just keep your feet flat on the floor and your knees bent. And really come to a place of total relaxation. So even the muscles in the forehead, and the eyes and the cheeks relax and drop. Shoulders and the arms heavy in the floor, as are the hips and the legs and the feet. Coming back to whatever breath is natural to you. Start to breathe a little bit deeper, re-energizing yourself, wiggling fingers and toes, turning the head from side to side. You can reach the arms up overhead, take a big stretch as if you were just waking up in the morning. Then we'll roll over to one side. Use your arms to help yourself come up and take a seat. Letting the eyes close, hands can rest on the knees. Sit up tall and just take a moment to observe how you feel now as opposed to when you first stepped onto your mat. Let's bring our hands together, Anjali Mudra, at the front of the heart. Closing our practice with one chant of Om. You're welcome to just listen or join in. So we'll inhale to chant. Inhale. Om. Namaste. Thank you so very much for doing this beginner yin yoga class with me. I do hope you enjoyed it. Please make sure to subscribe to Melissa's YouTube channel if you don't already. And if you enjoyed this class, please head over to my Yoga with Kassandra YouTube channel and you can subscribe there as well. I have a new video every Thursday. Thank you so very much. Have a wonderful day.
Melissa would love to hear your questions and thoughts. Please leave your comments below the video. Thank you for your reviews on iTunes and YouTube. Your reviews help us to share yoga and a yoga lifestyle with others around the world. If you have a question for Melissa, you can leave a voice message at melissawest.com, and Melissa may answer it in an upcoming blog.